Wollstonecraft and British Suffragettes by Sanderson Beck. Reforms of the 19th century brought an end to human slavery, the most outrageous violation in civilized nations. What Victor Hugo proclaimed the century of woman also began the struggle to liberate women from subjection to patriarchal traditions that had existed in most cultures since the beginning of recorded history. Successful achievement of the vote for women was not attained by Great Britain until 1918 and by the United States in 1920. Those heroic efforts were for the most part nonviolent. New Zealand allowed women to vote in 1893, Australia in 1902, Finland in 1906, Norway in 1913, and Russia in 1917. By 1939, another 26 nations had granted female suffrage. France, Italy, Romania, Yugoslavia, and China did not allow women to vote until shortly after World War II. In 1952, the United Nations Convention on the Political Rights of Women declared, "Women shall be entitled to vote in all elections on equal terms with men, without any discrimination." By 1965, women could vote in more than 100 nations. Before exploring the great pioneer of the women's rights movement in the modern era, Mary Wollstonecraft, who wrote the book that made a powerful case for women's rights, we may note that as early as 1739, an author calling herself Sophia, in Woman Not Inferior to Man, proposed better education for women for independence, and so that they could become good teachers, physicians, lawyers, soldiers, and philosophers. The following year, in Woman's Superior Excellence to Man, Sophia responded to criticism by acknowledging the faults of women, but suggested they resulted from inadequate education and male tyranny. Wollstonecraft's contemporaries Condorcet and Catherine Macaulay also called for improved education of girls. Mary Wollstonecraft. It is time to effect a revolution in female manners, time to restore to them their lost dignity, and make them, as a part of the human species, labor by reforming themselves to reform the world. Mary Wollstonecraft, A Vindication of the Rights of Woman. I do not wish them to have power over men, but over themselves. Mary Wollstonecraft, A Vindication of the Rights of Woman. Would men but generously snap our chains and be content with rational fellowship instead of slavish obedience, they would find us more observant daughters, more affectionate sisters, more faithful wives, more reasonable mothers, in a word, better citizens. We should then love them with true affection, because we should learn to respect ourselves, and the peace of mind of a worthy man would not be interrupted by the idle vanity of his wife. Mary Wollstonecraft, A Vindication of the Rights of Woman. Mary Wollstonecraft was born in London on April 27, 1759. Her father had a drinking problem, and Mary had to take care of younger sisters. She began working as a companion when she was 19 and spent 2 years nursing her mother, who died in 1782. Mary helped her sister Eliza separate from her husband, whose cruel treatment she believed caused Eliza's breakdown. Eliza, Mary, and her best friend, Fanny Blood, started a school northeast of London that was guided by the dissenting minister, Richard Price. Mary's sister, Everina, also joined them. Mary was with Fanny Blood when she died during childbirth in Lisbon, and the school closed 3 months later. In 1786, Mary Wollstonecraft wrote Thoughts on the Education of Daughters, in which she recommended mothers suckle their babies to produce affection. Whenever a child asks a question, a reasonable answer should be given. She noted that love without esteem will probably degenerate, but love for a worthy person is an incentive for improvement. Mary suggested that women cultivate their minds so that they may be content if comfortable and consoled if not. Mary Wollstonecraft took employment in Dublin, but was dismissed after arousing the jealousy of Lady Kingsborough. After that, she did not serve in another woman's household, but was able to make her living as a writer. Her autobiographical novel, Mary, a Fiction, was published in 1788. She wrote articles for the Analytical Review and published The Female Reader under a pseudonym. She translated books from French and German and published original stories from real life for children. After the conservative Edmund Burke attacked the rights of man in his famous Reflections on the Revolution in France, Mary Wollstonecraft wrote A Vindication of the Rights of Men anonymously in 1790, but added her name the next year. She criticized Burke for defending the property rights of the wealthy more than human rights. She argued that the progress of civilization has been delayed by hereditary property and hereditary honors. She argued that true happiness arose from the friendship and intimacy which can only be enjoyed by equals, and that charity is not a condescending distribution of alms, but an intercourse of good offices and mutual benefits, founded on respect for justice and humanity. The rights that humans inherit from birth derive not from their forefathers, but from God. She believed that submission to authority should not be endless, but must stop, or they return to barbarism. She was outraged that Burke defined English liberty as security of property, and every nobler liberty was sacrificed to this selfish principle. A thief is punished with death, but violence or killing a person is considered a less heinous offense. Mary Wollstonecraft's great work, A Vindication of the Rights of Woman, was published in 1792 and revised the same year. In her circle of friends, she was intellectually stimulated by Thomas Paine, William Blake, Joseph Priestley, and Henry Fuseli, for whom she had a brief passion that did not work out because he was married. While at Paris during the Reign of Terror, she became the lover of the American Gilbert Imlay and gave birth to his daughter Fanny in 1794, even though they did not marry. That year, she published her 522-page Historical and Moral View of the Origin and Progress of the French Revolution. Back in London, Mary attempted suicide twice. After publishing her letters from Scandinavia, she became involved with the radical political thinker William Godwin. They were married on March 29, 1797, and Mary worked on her second novel, The Wrongs of Woman, or Maria. She died of an infection 11 days after the birth of her daughter, Mary Godwin, who grew up to marry the poet Shelley and write the novel Frankenstein. A Vindication of the Rights of Woman was dedicated to the French diplomat Talleyrand, with the request that he consider including women in the rights of citizens to national education. To exclude women from their new constitution would leave them open to charges of injustice and tyranny, and would undermine morality. In the introduction, Mary Wollstonecraft noted charges against masculine women, but she argued that in terms of developing rational qualities, it is better for women to become more masculine and respectable rather than being satisfied with limited beauty and elegance. She also encouraged men to become more modest and chaste. In discussing the rights and duties of humanity, she argued that reason and virtue separate humans from brutes. Rousseau tried to show that everything was all right originally. Many authors argued that things are all right now, but she aimed to prove that things will be all right. She based her belief on the perfection of God. She noted that kings often gained their power by vile and unnatural crimes. She held that standing armies are incompatible with freedom because subordination depends on despotism. Mary Wollstonecraft discussed the prevailing opinions about women, and she asked why women should be kept in ignorance under the specious reason of innocence. She observed that women have been led astray by false refinement, but should be allowed to develop their reason just as men are. She compared the truncated education of women to the opposite extreme of military men. Both acquire manners but lack moral development because they are expected to submit blindly to authority. Learning the art of pleasing is useful only to a mistress. But the chaste wife and serious mother must develop virtues in order to be respectable. For women to purify their hearts, they need to learn more than developing their senses for amusement. The woman who strengthens her body and exercises her mind by managing her family and practicing virtues may become the friend of her husband rather than a humble dependent. She objected to the idea that they were made to be loved and must not aim at respect, lest they should be hunted out of society as masculine. Wollstonecraft argued that if morality has an eternal standard, there can be only one rule of right for all. Since liberty is the mother of virtue, why should women by their constitution be slaves and languish like exotics, as beautiful flaws in nature, when they could breathe the sharp and invigorating air of freedom? Liberty will make women wiser and more virtuous. She acknowledged that a man has more bodily strength than a woman, but she insisted that the virtue and knowledge of the two sexes should be the same. Therefore, women should have the same opportunities to acquire both. She suggested that in their enlightened age, the divine right of husbands could be challenged just as the Americans and French challenged the divine right of kings. She complained that girls are taught from infancy that beauty is their scepter, and that thus their mind should be shaped by their body so that it roams in a gilded cage adorning its prison. She called for a revolution in manners that would restore the lost female dignity. By working to reform themselves, they could reform the world. Independence of character is based on understanding. Women must only bow to the authority of reason instead of being the modest slaves of opinion. Next, Wollstonecraft discussed the various causes by which women are reduced to degradation. Women were not created just to console men. Women have always been slaves, except in rare cases when they were despots, yet both retard the progress of reason. When men do homage to women by exalting their inferiority, they are tyrannizing over the weakness they cherish. She believed that women are degraded by receiving trivial attentions because of their sex. The love of pleasure makes a woman's circumstances trifling, and without duties, her concerns are on secondary things or adventures. When the passions are pampered while the judgment is neglected, what else can result but madness and folly? In Emile, Rousseau wrote that if women are educated like men, they will become like men and thus have less power over men. But Wollstonecraft did not want women to have power over men, but over themselves. She was concerned that the power of female beauty was fleeting because it lasted only for a few years. If female education develops only the romantic side, it is vain and mean. By educating nature and reason, women can become more virtuous and useful as they become more respectable. Wollstonecraft described how contemporary authors have rendered women objects of pity. She complained that Rousseau wanted to educate Sophia to be weak and passive so that she will be agreeable to her master, as if that were the grand purpose of her existence. Much of girls' and women's attention is given to superficial things, like clothes. She was concerned about the effects of early impressions on character. She hoped that through rational education, a woman would be contented to love once and after marriage let passion calmly subside into friendship built on pure affections that would not disturb the sober duties of life. She defined modesty as not thinking more highly of oneself than one ought to think, and distinguished it from the self-abasement of humility. She believed true love makes the lover more modest in her presence. A sober mind is attained by the exercise of duties and the pursuit of knowledge. The alternative for the dependent woman is to be loved only as long as she is fair. She observed that most people are more concerned with their reputation than their actual chastity. She noted that the two sexes either mutually corrupted or improved each other. Morality will never improve until more equality is established in society. One cannot expect women to be more virtuous until they are independent of men, for women that are absolutely dependent on men tend to be cunning, mean, and selfish. Men, gratified by the fawning fondness of spaniel-like affection, have little delicacy because love cannot be bought. Wollstonecraft observed that riches debased women even more than men because the latter could still engage their faculties as soldiers and statesmen. She criticized the class structure that divided the world between voluptuous tyrants and envious dependents. Benevolent legislators encourage private virtue to promote public happiness. Pleasures weaken women by making them slaves to their persons to allure men, or they manipulate their tyrants with sinister tricks. In addition to discharging her civil duties, managing her family, educating her children, and assisting her neighbors, a woman should be independent of her husband's bounty so that she can be generous on her own. She asked if morality is not wounded when poverty becomes even more disgraceful than vice. Wollstonecraft believed that women could be physicians as well as nurses, study politics, and pursue business if they're educated properly. Many could be saved from common and legal prostitution because they would not have to marry for support. Yet, in her time, most of the jobs open to women were menial, and even governesses were not treated like tutors. She argued that a woman who earns her own bread is much more respectable than the most accomplished beauty. She entreated men to emancipate their companions. The woman who is not allowed to govern her own conduct will not have sufficient sense to be a good mother. She noted how girls are kept down by their parents more than boys. She often repeated how rights and duties must go together. Until esteem and love are joined together and reason becomes the foundation of duty, morality will stumble. Criticizing the problems of current private and public schools, Wollstonecraft recommended boys and girls be educated together in day schools open to all classes funded by the government. After the age of 9, most boys and girls could go on to learn trades, while those with superior abilities could learn languages, science, history, politics, and literature. Such would be schools for human morality and happiness. She objected to tyrannical punishments and suggested that students be tried by their peers to learn justice. Humane treatment of animals should be taught. Those made free will quickly become wise and virtuous. She warned against sentimental education and suggested ridiculing cheap novels to make students more discriminating. She concluded that women will correct their vices and follies when they are allowed to be free. When women share the rights of men, they will also share his virtues and will grow more perfect when emancipated. Mill, Pankhurst, and British Suffragettes. All over America, the suffragists declare that they have gained hope and inspiration from our own great British movement. In the early days of our long struggle, it was we who drew our inspiration from them. Our movements act and react on each other. Sylvia Pankhurst, 1911. We should take no denial, but go in procession to interview him nevertheless. I should accompany the deputation. My license having expired, I should be rearrested, of course. Then I should not only repeat the usual hunger and thirst strike in prison, but continue it after release until the deputations should be received. Sylvia Pankhurst, May 30th, 1914. The English Reform Bill of 1832 used the term male person for the first time in English history, and women objected to the word male in the Municipal Reform Act of 1835. Richard Cobden, the strongest advocate for peace in the Parliament, publicly spoke out for women's suffrage in 1845 and 1848. Harriet Taylor, in 1851, wrote the essay Enfranchisement of Women, in which she reported that the Women's Rights Convention in Worcester, Massachusetts, was attended by more than 1,000 people demanding equal rights for women in education, employment, voting, and holding offices. She answered the maternity argument by saying that women can and should be more than mothers. She believed that working women could supplement their husband's income or earn their own living. She noted that women may have needed protection in a previous age of violence, but now that is no longer necessary. She presented the real question as whether it is right and expedient that one half of the human race should pass through life in a state of forced subordination to the other half. Because many women do not seek their emancipation is not an argument against it, just as the vast numbers in Asia who submit to being veiled and dominated by men is not necessarily a good thing that may not change in the future. At the end of her essay, she noted that a petition for the franchise from the women of Sheffield was presented to the House of Lords in February 1851. Harriet Taylor married her close friend of 20 years, John Stuart Mill, 1806-73, in 1851, and had a strong influence on him before she died in 1858. The Northern Reform Society was organized that year and made universal suffrage its objective. Mill published Representative Government in 1861, arguing that women needed the vote so that they may not be misgoverned by men, and he discussed the benefits that would result from women voting. Mill had been arrested when he was 17 for distributing information on birth control. When Mill presented in the House of Commons a petition to give women the franchise in 1866, it was greeted with laughter. Disraeli suggested that women with property should have the vote. During debates on the Tories' Reform Act of 1867, Mill made the first plea ever heard for women's suffrage in the British Parliament. But his amendment to replace the word man with person was defeated. Attempts to test whether the generic term man included women failed in the courts. Mill wrote The Subjection of Women in 1861, but did not publish it until 1869. He began with the basic premise that the principle which regulates the existing social relations between the two sexes, the legal subordination of one sex to the other, is wrong in itself, and now one of the chief hindrances to human improvement, and that it ought to be replaced by a principle of perfect equality, admitting no power or privilege on the one side, nor disability on the other. The law should treat all people alike except for positive reasons of justice or policy. Mill suggested that the opinion which allowed men to subordinate women is not based on any deliberate thought, but was the result of the law of the strongest. He noted that even the powerful church has not been able to renounce violence and force. Women suffer from a chronic condition of bribery and intimidation. The subordination of women has been such a universal custom for so long that any departure from it seems unnatural. He compared it to the slavery of barbarians by the Greeks and of Africans in his own century. But men want more than just obedience from women. They want their sentiments and willing submission. Thus, moralities have been devised to make it the duty of women to focus all their affections on their husbands and the children they have by them. Yet Mill believed that the entire course of history is away from systems of unequal rights and toward human improvement for all, and that the condition of women is approaching equality with men. He doubted that men had the knowledge that would qualify them to lay down the law for women as to their vocations. But he believed it is better for women to decide for themselves by their own experience. Mill reviewed how oppressive were current laws of various countries against women, and he noted that often women are treated much better than those hellish laws. Loving liberty, Mill disliked both sides of commanding and obeying, and he believed that society is progressing toward equal associations. The virtue of humans is that they can live together as equals, claiming nothing that they do not freely concede to others. He acknowledged that the family is a school of obedience for children, as parents learn to command. But he saw also that it needed to be a school of sympathy in equality, of living together in love, without power on one side or obedience on the other. He lamented that the development of women had been hindered. When that is corrected, he expected there would be no difference between the character and capacities of the sexes. He suggested that the complaint against women is that they fulfill the only duties they are taught too faithfully. In the last section, Mill asked if mankind would be better off if women are free. First, it would be greatly advantageous if human relations were regulated by justice instead of injustice. Second, giving women free choice of employment and opening more occupations to them would double the mental faculties available to serve humanity. Furthermore, the influence women already have toward averting wars and increasing charity would be greatly enhanced. Mill found himself from his marriage to Harriet Taylor that a loving and equal relationship with reciprocal duties is the ideal. He concluded, "The moral regeneration of mankind will only really commence when the most fundamental of the social relations is placed under the rule of equal justice, and when human beings learn to cultivate their strongest sympathy with an equal in rights and in cultivation." In 1865, a Society for Women's Suffrage had been formed in Manchester, and they printed 10,000 copies of Lydia Becker's paper advocating the franchise. In 1869, English women gained municipal suffrage, and Scotland adopted it in 1882. The Woman's Disabilities Removal Bill was drafted by Dr. Richard Pankhurst and was introduced by Jacob Bright in 1871 to give women the vote. It was considered favorably by Gladstone, but was defeated. Florence Nightingale and Harriet Martineau led the drive that submitted 18,000 signatures from women on memorials. Mrs. Wollstonecraft Elmy worked to get the Married Women's Property Acts of 1870 and 1882 passed. Married mothers gained guardianship of their children in the Custody of Infants Act of 1886. In Europe, Marie Gogue founded the Women's International Association at Geneva in 1868, and the first International Women's Rights Congress was held at Paris in 1878. In 1889, Mrs. Emmeline Pankhurst organized the Women's Franchise League to gain the vote and equality for women in divorce, inheritance, and the custody of children. Dr. Pankhurst had stood up for the Boer Republics, and after his death, Mrs. Pankhurst resigned from the Fabian Society in 1900 after it refused to oppose the Boer War. In October 1903, she joined with a few women from the Independent Labor Party, ILP, to form the Women's Social and Political Union, WSPU. Worker Annie Kenney was elected to the Committee of the Card and Blowing Room Operatives. When Edward Grey came to speak in the Manchester Free Trade Hall on October 13, 1905, Annie Kenney put up a banner, "Votes for Women." Mrs. Pankhurst's eldest daughter, Christabel, repeated her questioning and fought to keep from being ejected. Both were thrown out and arrested. Christabel was charged with spitting at a police superintendent and an inspector. Refusing to pay fines, they went to prison. Christabel for 7 days and Annie for 3. Liberal candidate Winston Churchill tried to pay their fines, but the governor would not accept his money. Annie Kenney displayed another banner when Prime Minister Henry Campbell Bannerman spoke at Albert Hall. At another meeting, Churchill refused to answer the questions of Christabel's sister, Sylvia Pankhurst. Mrs. Pethick Lawrence became treasurer of the WSPU. After Annie Kenney and two others were arrested on Downing Street, 200 members of Parliament formed a women's suffrage committee and petitioned Prime Minister Campbell Bannerman, who refused to initiate any such legislation. Lloyd George told protesters he was a suffragist and suggested they go to their enemy Asquith, at whose residence 30 women were attacked by police. Kenney and two others were sent to prison for 6 weeks. Dora B. Montefiore had refused to pay income tax because taxation without representation is tyranny. Her house was besieged for 6 weeks before one piece of furniture could be taken in 1906. By then, Christabel Pankhurst had earned a law degree from Victoria University. On October 23, 1906, Mrs. Pankhurst and 9 women were arrested for sitting down in the lobby of the Parliament and went to prison. Sylvia Pankhurst also tried to speak and got 14 days. News spread, and for the first time in France, 150 women demonstrated for the vote in the Chamber of Deputies. In February 1907, a women's parliament was held in Caxton Hall, and they marched to the House of Commons. 54 women and 2 men were arrested as mounted police cleared Parliament Square. That year, Emmeline and Frederick Pethick Lawrence founded the newspaper Votes for Women and gave it to the Union in 1908. 5,000 meetings for women's suffrage were organized, including one at Albert Hall. Despite the efforts of Keir Hardie, the Pankhurst and WSPU members withdrew from the Labor Party. Women heckled politicians at public meetings and at private functions. After a women's parliament in February 1908 led to another demonstration, 48 women were sentenced to 2 months. Mrs. Pankhurst tried to speak on a cart and was arrested with 8 women, getting 6 weeks. To prevent an announced public meeting in Parliamentary Square, 5,000 foot police and 50 mounted officers assembled on June 30th. Yet women spoke from the steps of government buildings. A few frustrated women went to Downing Street and threw stones. 27 women went to prison. Christabel Pankhurst, her mother, and Mrs. Drummond were ordered arrested for printing handbills saying, "Help the suffragettes rush the House of Commons." On October 13, 1908, at Parliament Square, 24 women and 12 men were arrested and went to prison for 3 weeks to 2 months. Christabel was sentenced to 10 weeks, and the two older women got 3 months. Jenny Baines was sentenced to 6 weeks for throwing herself on the Prime Minister at Leeds. Sylvia Pankhurst told Helen Ogston not to use a dog whip, but at Albert Hall she used it against police after they burned her wrist and struck her in the chest. As a result, many women were beaten. 26 members of the Women's Freedom League were arrested trying to interview cabinet ministers at Downing Street in January 1909. At the 6th Women's Parliament the next month, police took leaders into custody and violently manhandled the others to push them back. 21 women were arrested at the Women's Parliament on March 30th and got 1 to 3 months in prison. During the 8th Women's Parliament on June 29, 1909, government window panes were broken for the first time because those that broke a window were quietly taken into custody instead of beaten. 108 were arrested, including Alice Paul of Pennsylvania. All were freed, but 14 who were charged for breaking windows or rescuing others. They demanded political status in prison, smashed windows in their cells because of stifling heat, and went on hunger strikes. 12 more were arrested and did the same, and they were released after 4 to 6 days of fasting. Other small groups had a similar experience. Mrs. Pankhurst and Christabel defended the tactic of throwing stones. After 37 women had shortened their sentences by fasting, the Home Secretary ordered Birmingham prisoners forcibly fed by a rubber tube in September 1909. Medical doctors complained that this was brutal and dangerous, 116 physicians sending a memorial to the Prime Minister. In June 1910, the Conciliation Committee promoted a bill to give women with property the vote. November 18th became known as Black Friday, as 300 women in detachments of 12 for 6 hours were attacked by police, who snatched their flags and tore them up, hit the women with their fists and knees, knocking them down and dragging them to the crowd of spectators. 2 men and 115 women were arrested, but only women accused of breaking windows or assault were charged. That night, women broke windows of cabinet ministers' houses, and after 3 days, a total of 285 had been arrested. 75 women went to prison for window breaking and assault. 10 admitted they struck police to protect other women. After this, stone throwing became organized. In March 1911, the Pethick Lawrences were arrested, and Christabel Pankhurst fled to Paris. In China, suffragists rushed the chamber of the Nanjing Assembly, broke windows, and assaulted members. Soldiers were called in, but women were given the vote. Imprisoned women in England went on hunger strikes for prisoner privileges and were fed by force until most had been released. Then the remainder were given their rights. The jury recommended leniency to Mrs. Pankhurst and Mr. and Mrs. Pethick Lawrence, but the judge sentenced them to 9 months and refused to let them be treated as first-class misdemeanants. They fasted, resisted force feeding, and were soon released. Emily Wilding Davidson and Nurse Pitfield committed arson openly and accepted punishment. But in July 1912, Christabel Pankhurst from Paris began organizing secret arson attacks, a strategy opposed by her sister Sylvia and the Pethick Lawrences, who withdrew from the WSPU in October. Votes for women went back to the Pethick Lawrences, and the WSPU began publishing The Suffragette. In the campaign of the new militancy directed by Christabel and her mother, attempts were made to destroy mail in pillar boxes with red ochre, jam, tar, varnish, and inflammable substances. False fire alarms were made 176 times in 1911 and 425 times the next year, resulting in 50 convictions. The numbers increased in 1913. Arson began targeting works of art and historic relics. Sylvia Pankhurst turned her efforts to developing a mass movement in the poor East End of London. Objecting to police brutality at the station, Sylvia spilled an ink pot and slapped the superintendent with her inky hand. At that time, the WSPU was paying fines and she was released. On her third arrest, she was not allowed a fine and was sentenced to 2 months' hard labor. She and Zellie Emerson went on hunger strikes and endured the misery of force feeding. Sylvia decided to walk until she was released and finally was taken to a doctor and sent home. Parliament passed the Cat and Mouse Act that licensed out hunger strikers for short terms, suspending their sentences until they returned to prison. Bernard Shaw objected. If you take a woman and torture her, you torture me. These denials of fundamental rights are really a violation of the soul. Mrs. Pankhurst claimed responsibility for the militant campaign and was sentenced to 3 years. After she was emaciated from fasting, she was licensed out for a time. Parliament decided to crush the WSPU campaign by suppressing their meetings. Emily Wilding Davison had tried to kill herself in prison twice by throwing herself over corridor railings, but she was caught by a wire net. She also threw herself down an iron staircase. She never recovered from these injuries, And at the Derby on June 4, 1913, she was killed trying to stop the king's horse during the race. Sylvia Pankhurst was sentenced to serve 3 months. Under the Cat and Mouse Act, she, her mother, and other mice would spend a few days in prison, refusing food and water until they were released on license for 7 days. Then the cats would try to find the mice and arrest them again when they spoke at meetings, if their supporters were not able to protect and hide them. Soon, 31 women and 4 men were being moused. On July 26, 1913, the non-militant National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies, NUWSS, organized a massive meeting at Hyde Park. Because of riots and civil war in Ireland, the British government began to grant some suffrage rights to the Unionist women of Ulster, bolstering the militants' view that their tactics were effective. Hundreds of fires had been set, but only 13 persons were convicted of arson. In Paris, the autocratic Christabel Pankhurst demanded that her sister Sylvia's less violent East London Federation become separate from the WSPU, because Christabel did not approve of the Federation's democratic constitution and working women's movement. Violence escalated as the press reported 141 acts of destruction in the first 7 months of 1914, with 35 arrests and 107 cases of arson with 9 arrests. Some prisons, particularly in Scotland, were still force-feeding hunger strikers. When war came in August 1914, all the suffragettes were released. Mrs. Pankhurst, Christabel, and most of those using violent tactics supported the war effort by making recruiting speeches and stopped demanding suffrage until after the war. But the more nonviolent Sylvia Pankhurst and her East End poor people organized charitable war relief and continued the hard work for women's rights. Mrs. Fawcett and a majority of the non-militant NUWSS dropped the suffrage campaign to support the war effort, while a minority joined the peace efforts of the Women's International League. Sylvia's Federation asked the New Zealand system of franchise for every woman over 21 and noted that 4 provinces in Canada granted complete women's suffrage during the war. They joined with 7 London labor organizations and persistently lobbied the House of Commons. While the militarists, such as Christabel, agitated for conscription of all men and women from 16 to 60 years of age, Sylvia Pankhurst demanded human suffrage and no infringement of liberties. Some of the suffragettes joined Jane Addams at The Hague in 1915 to work for peace and international order. In 1917, the tide turned, and finally, on January 11, 1918, the House of Lords approved the bill that gave the vote to 8 million women. Complete woman suffrage was granted in Britain by the Act of 1928.